Hey everyone, this lesson is on scabies. In this lesson, we're going to talk about what scabies is, how it's transmitted, the pathogenesis of scabies. We'll also talk about different types of scabies, and we'll talk about how we can treat scabies. So scabies is a skin condition due to infestation by mites of the species Sarcoptes scabiei. So here's an image of that mite. So the transmission risk factors of scabies includes crowding. So you can imagine if there's a lot of individuals around, any of those individuals that might have scabies can pass those scabies along to other individuals. Skin to skin contact is probably one of the largest ways how these mites get transmitted. And generally speaking, skin to skin contact has to be direct and it has to be prolonged. So casual skin to skin contact will not usually transmit scabies from one individual to another. So it has to be direct and prolonged. Another way scabies can be transmitted is through fomites. Now, fomites are things like furniture. So chairs, beds, desks, anything that an individual with scabies might have touched, leaving mites behind on those surfaces. And then another individual comes along and touches that surface, they can have scabies transmitted through that way. This is generally not the case in certain types of scabies, but there is one type of scabies I want to talk to you about that this can be transmitted through fomites or through indirect contact with furniture. And scabies, these mites of Sarcoptes scabiei, can live for about 1 to 1.5 days without a host. So they can live on a surface for a while, but eventually they will die. So what is the pathogenesis of scabies? So just to warn you, the next few things I'm going to talk about may be distressing for some individuals. So first, a female mite is what generally causes the signs and symptoms of scabies we'll talk about a little later. So what happens is a female mite secretes proteolytic enzymes, these enzymes that can break down proteins and enter into the skin. It allows them to enter into the epidermal layer of the skin, the outer surface layer of the skin. And when they enter, they burrow in and lay about 2 to 3 eggs per day for about 4 to 6 weeks until they die. Once those eggs get laid, the larvae hatch from those eggs within 3 to 4 days. And this is how the cycle of scabies and these mites continue to infest and cause these signs and symptoms. So what are the signs and symptoms of scabies? So first I want to say that there are two types of scabies. There's a classic scabies and crusted scabies. Both of these have different signs and symptoms and different distribution of infections on the body. So the first one we're going to talk about is the classic scabies. So classic scabies looks like this. It involves eruption of small erythematous papules, and it has an appearance of what we call knots on a rope. So if you were to take a look at this image here, you can see that there's generally a line that kind of attaches these three little papules. So there's a very faint line, you may not see it, but then you've got these three little papules that line up on the line. So these are the knots essentially on a rope. This is what we say the classic appearance of classic scabies is, knots on a rope. And the big characteristic symptom of classic scabies is pruritus, and it's generally severe pruritus. So they get very, very itchy. And the pruritus is often, again, severe and worse at night. This is again a very common and characteristic finding, worse pruritus at night. The pruritus will begin to occur about 3 to 6 weeks after initial colonization. It seems to be due to a delayed hypersensitivity reaction to the mites. But if an individual had been infected with mites before, they cleared the infection or the infestation, and then they were reinfested with mites again, they can actually get pruritus quicker and usually can be within 1 to 3 days after a reinfestation. There is a particular characteristic skin distribution of classic scabies. Generally speaking, the skin distribution involves the webs of the fingers, the axilla, so the armpit, the areola, and the genitalia are generally where classic scabies affects individuals. The other type of scabies is crusted scabies. Crusted scabies is also known as Norwegian scabies. It's less common than classic scabies. It occurs in patients with immunosuppression. Very key here is that crusted scabies occurs in individuals with immunosuppression. HIV patients, older patients, patients with cancers like lymphoma or on chemotherapies are more likely to get crusted scabies. Crusted scabies has a higher mite burden, so there's more of these Sarcoptes mites in crusted scabies as opposed to the classic scabies. And transmission via fomites is more common in crusted scabies than it is in classic scabies. So you can imagine that if there's lots of mites, more mites, if an individual with crusted scabies touches a fomite, they're leaving even more mites behind. So this is why transmission via fomites can be more common with the crusted scabies. And hands and and feet, along with the scalp, are where crusted scabies affects individuals. So how do we make the diagnosis and how do we treat scabies? The diagnosis of scabies can occur by microscopy, so you can look at it under a microscope and see mites and or eggs. That can be a way to diagnose scabies, but oftentimes scabies is diagnosed clinically. So in classic scabies, we can see pruritus, that's worse at night, knot on a rope appearance of the skin lesions can be very characteristic, and you can see a characteristic distribution where head is spared. That is again classic scabies. If it's crusted scabies, you can see crusting, scaling, and fissuring that affects an older immunosuppressed adult. So once we've made the diagnosis, how do we treat scabies? We can use topical permethrin. So topical permethrin can be used to treat scabies, and we can use ivermectin to treat scabies as well. So if you want to learn more about other skin conditions, please check out my dermatology playlist. And if you haven't already, please consider liking, subscribing, and clicking the notification bell to help support the channel. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you next time.